Hey everyone, and welcome to Boston Autoblog. There's convertibles, and then there's the Aston Martin DB11, a car that's striking for the exterior, but also comfortable, plush, and more importantly, driver-centric for the interior. It's exactly what you'd expect from an Aston Martin. But a lot of brand loyalists and traditionalists are going to say that this manufacturer has changed quite a bit from where we were, say, 15 to 20 years ago. Not only when it comes to the styling, but also the components under the hood and the interior, but also where the brand has come, where the lineup is, especially in 2021. The Vantage is nothing like its predecessor. Also, we have a crossover with the DBX, and the DBS Superleggera is certainly a car of the present and for 2021. But the DB11 is drawing inspiration from the proud history of this British manufacturer, especially when it comes to styling. But we have to return to the brand loyalists, because they're going to say that under the hood is a V8 from Mercedes-Benz, that this car growls and snorts like a warthog, and the technology that you find on the dashboard is also from Mercedes-Benz. But I am here to say that should not take away from this amazing Grand Tour, and that if you are looking for a stylish and upscale premium convertible or Volante, then maybe going with the Aston Martin DB11 might be a great decision. Now, before we get into this video, I want to give a huge shout and thank you to Aston Martin of Boston in Norwood, Massachusetts, for allowing me to do this review. Their link will be in the description below, so you can check out their extensive Aston Martin and used exotic inventory. Also, before we get started, make sure to hit the subscribe button and also click the notification bell so you're notified every time a new video goes live on the channel. And so, without wasting any further time, let's get right in this review. So we are now behind the wheel of the Aston Martin DB11, and this is a perfect comparison to the Ferrari Roma that I featured late last year. I love that car. It was a Grand Tour, and this is a Grand Tour. We look at the Aston Martin Vantage as being the Grand Tour in the lineup, but when you start looking at its tendencies, how it drives, how it handles, how it feels on the interior, it's more like a sports car. Whereas a DB11 is a true gentleman's vehicle for sure. And you can tell by the interior comfort as well. When you look at the Vantage, it's a bit more sports car oriented, where this is nice leather materials, nice and soft, but also even the way it just drives and handles, it's a lot more comfortable to drive. The sound of that V8 is incredible. It resonates so well into the interior. Now let's first start off with the vision of the DB11. There's really not a whole lot of it, especially for the rear. You have a very small window to see what's behind you. The mirrors are placed really well. And then of course we have that lower roof line. So I have a very small window in front of me, but this, I feel like I'm in a cocoon. I feel like I have the entire interior wrapped around me. Now, when you look at where Aston Martin is today with the designs, they're not like other brands that they compete against. So when you look at Porsche, you look at Bentley, you look at Ferrari, there's a lineage there, and you can actually trace the history of the car that's currently on the market. Whereas Aston Martin has switched so many different ownership groups throughout the years that each generation, each decade is completely different. I would argue though that the DB11 is really the only car in the Aston Martin lineup right now where traditional buyers are going to recognize it. Because if you look at the Vantage, it's completely different than the Vantage that came before it. And then when you look at the Aston Martin DBX, I mean, can you believe that we actually have a crossover in the lineup? But then also you have the DBS Superleggera, and these cars have come a long way. But also when you look at the fact that you have Mercedes-Benz technology for the interior, which you can actually turn off this infotainment system, which I love because I'm really focused on the driving aspect more than the technology. But also you have the V8 under the hood from Mercedes-Benz as well. And it really makes these cars come to life. They're no longer just the Grand Tour anymore. They're a car that's going to have a lot of fun and excitement to them, a car that you're going to want to drive on a daily basis. That's exactly what the DB11 is. What I really like too about the Aston Martin DB11 is that it doesn't want to kill you when you want to accelerate in the corners, whereas the Ferrari Roma just wanted to track to the closest tree line, and that was a bit stressful. Now, of course, it was like 30 degrees out when I drove that car, but the DB11 feels planted, it feels smooth, and this is just what a driver's car is all about. That's what I feel with Aston Martin right now. They're one of the last brands that's all about the driver, being driver focused. Even Porsche today has all this technology now drawing you in with some of those nice infotainment systems, even the full digital gauge cluster. It's not what Porsche used to be. Whereas right now with the Aston Martin lineup, it's all about the driver, and I can truly appreciate that. Oh my gosh. You get that kickback. It's just fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. So since we are on an empty road here, there's no one around, there's no houses. It's pretty much a deserted road. Gonna do a quick acceleration here and get a good feel of what this car is capable of. The thing I like about the DB11 is that it's linear. The power is linear. Sure, you have the V8, you have this tremendous amount of torque, but you're not going to worry about having the rear end kick out on you. It's a true Grand Tour is what it is. A lot of drivers who have the money to buy an Aston Martin DB11 who might be a bit concerned, like, oh, is it too much power? Is it going to be too much for me? Not at all. In fact, I would argue that this is the anti-Ferrari Roma, because the Ferrari Roma, to me, wanted to actually kill me in the corners. Even in a straight line, the car just wanted to go to the nearest tree line, whereas this feels planted. The steering feels really nice as well, and I'm in Sport Plus mode. So the fact that I have the car in Sport Plus mode and I don't feel like the car is getting away from me is really important. Gosh. And this right here is why a lot of Aston Martin loyalists may not be turned on by what Aston Martin has done over the last 5 years. The V8 might be a bit too growly. It sounds like a hippo or a warthog snorting. That's how loud this car really is. And for some buyers, they might not like that, especially where Aston Martin was always this gentleman's car, more of the laid-back Grand Tour that you're not necessarily going to draw in a lot of attention. But today, not so much. The DB11 is certainly going to draw attention. Now, since I am not out in the canyon roads here, we're going to have to deal with some of these smaller roads, but I want to get a good feel of the corners. It just hugs the road. Incredible. It just feels so planted. This is what driving is all about right here. Those downshifts. They're addicting. Now, I don't know what the thought process is for most Aston Martin loyalists and traditionalists when it comes to the V8 under the hood for these cars. Now, when it comes to the interior layout, when it comes to the technology, I think you can overlook that. But when it comes to the exhaust note, when it comes to the V8, these cars are a lot more muscly. They're louder. They draw in attention. And before, Aston Martins would always be a car that would fly below the radar but fit the personalities of the driver. People who are more conservative, more laid back, more reserved. Guys who would show up to a 5-star restaurant in Monaco in a tuxedo to meet up and rendezvous with another agent. Aston Martin fit the personality of James Bond. Today, I don't necessarily think so, especially when you look at where the lineup is with the DBX, the Vantage, and even the DB11. I think the DB11, to me, is really the last traditional Bond car, if you want to go in that direction and say that. But I think Aston Martin is trying to make a name for themselves without pop culture, without Hollywood pumping this brand up. And I think that's going to help this manufacturer moving forward. When you look at the cars they're making, the DB11, the Vantage, the Superleggera, these are special cars, especially in a time when you have technology, you have computerized feels. This doesn't feel like that. This is one of the last remaining Grand Tours that is truly phenomenal and enjoyable to drive. When it comes to the steering feel, you can throw it into the corners, you can accelerate, and not worry about the car kicking out on you, although I can do feel it in the back when you are cornering a bit. But it's enjoyable, it's relaxing, and I think that's really where Aston Martin is always going to draw in a certain type of consumer, whether they like technology or not, whether they're 60-year-olds or 30-year-olds, there's a car for everybody in the lineup. And that's why even today in 2021, Aston Martin still does well when it comes to their Grand Tours. It's certainly softer over the bumps and horrible roads in New England. I can definitely take them and not cringe and not feel like I'm getting thrown around. It's just really a car that you want to drive at all times. I think you could daily drive this for sure, without question. Just because of how soft it is, the leather seats, even just the way the interior layout is, it's a car that's not meant to be on a track. It's not a car that's meant to be being pushed to its limits 100% of the time. This is a car you can drive up to New Hampshire or Maine or wherever you're going, maybe down to Florida, and you can just really enjoy the drive. It's really hurting me that I have to give the keys back in about 5 minutes because this is truly fantastic. This is what driving is all about. And it's so sad to see that a lot of brands don't have this anymore. But what I like too is that when it comes to the steering input, it's not super light like the Roma. The Roma is very darty, very responsive, but in a way it does take away from the driving experience because you're not wrestling the steering wheel. Now, even though the steering wheel isn't very tight, it's not very weighted, you still have some feedback, and I like that. But you can have some fun. You can have some fun and look professional doing it. And that's why the DB11 to me is still a very special car. But more importantly though, and this is what really stands out to me, what I can appreciate near the end of this test drive, is that the technology isn't thrown in my face. It's all about the driving dynamics. It's all about being zoned in. And there's not a lot of cars like that anymore on the road. Even the Roma today has a big infotainment system, has a very in-depth digital gauge cluster. It's not the same. We're losing that feel. We're losing what these cars were all about. And now we have a car, or we still have a car, that still gives you that technology feel, but at the same time, it's a Grand Tour. It's what driving is so much about, and that's why, as an enthusiast, this is a very special day for me. One more time in manual mode before I give the keys back. Incredible. Absolutely incredible. The ZF 8-speed pairs so well with this turbocharged V8 from Mercedes-Benz. It's intoxicating. It is totally intoxicating. Now, stepping inside the Aston Martin DB11 Volante, you are greeted by a comfortable, upscale, and sophisticated interior, one in which I do not want to leave and give the keys back to the dealership, because this is what owning an exotic or a premium luxury car is all about. You have full leather, you have a nice leather stitch dashboard, you have these leather seats that are really comfortable, provide a good amount of bolstering, but also how low you sit to the ground, you feel like you're one with the chassis of the car. You feel as one with the road, but also you feel connected the minute you step inside. I love the leather-wrapped steering wheel. I also love these paddle shifters. They're massive. They feel really good in the hands. And I'm not someone on this channel that tends to row through the gears myself, but they feel so good. They just entice you to really experience this car firsthand. Now, a lot of people are going to say, okay, you have Mercedes-Benz technology. But more importantly here is that you have a button you can turn off the infotainment system. So if you don't want to see what's in front of you or on the dashboard, you can just simply turn that off, and now you can just focus on the driving experience and focus on enjoying your drive. But also, this interior is fully customizable. If you want to, you can go with Alcantara, which would fit more of a sporty driving characteristic. If you're someone who is driving aggressively, that really wants to unleash the power that's under the hood, you can do that and have an interior that backs you up on that, that really fits right in. Or if you're somebody that's more responsible, enjoys the grand touring feel of the DB11, that maybe is going on shoreline drives or maybe going on some long weekend vacation, you can enjoy every single minute behind the wheel. Now, getting into the interior layout for the Aston Martin DB11, we're gonna start off on the steering wheel. And what you're gonna like here is that this car is focused on the driver rather than really drawing you in with eye candy. So your drive mode selector is gonna be on the right with your home and back button for the small information display on the right of this digital gauge cluster. Also, you will have a dial to scroll through different menus, so it makes it very easy to use while you're driving. Then on the left side, you will have your suspension modes. You can change from GT to Sport and Sport Plus to make you have more of a rigid suspension, really make you feel more connected to the car and the road. Or if you're just looking for more of a relaxed driving experience, you can change to more of a GT mode and just really enjoy driving this car around, even in the city or suburbs. Then when you look over to the dashboard layout, you will have a traditional row of buttons for your gear selector. Then beneath that, it's all Mercedes-Benz. And some people are gonna say, well, there's a lot of button clutter, but what I would say here is that once you get an idea of where these buttons are, it's very easy to use, becomes second nature for sure. But also more importantly is that because this is a Grand Tour, you're not really focused on the dashboard. You're really focused on what's ahead of you, focusing on feeling every gear shift, every, you know, downshift, and just the corners that lie ahead. But you will have a rotary dial and touchpad, similar to what we see with most Mercedes-Benz products. And I think the idea here is to keep your hands on the steering wheel, but also have your attention on the road ahead of you. And that's what Grand Tours are all about. A lot of older Grand Tours, like the Maserati Gran Turismo, don't offer a touchscreen. So it really is traditional to what we see in this segment. But I feel as though a lot of Aston Martin buyers, specifically for the DB11, are not focused on the infotainment system. They're not focused on the Mercedes-Benz technology. But as a journalist, I do need to bring it up and focus on that and just say whether I like it or not. But during my 35 minutes of test driving, I really didn't notice it at all. You also will have a nice compartment for the center console where you can fit a smartphone, your key fob. You also have two USB inputs, an SD card reader, and also a 12-volt outlet. Then, of course, on the center console itself, you will have the buttons that will control your seat positions. So everything is within arm's reach, very driver-centric, driver-focused, and that's why this car, even though it is somewhat minimalistic, it is pretty comfortable, it's enjoyable, and also if you are cross-shopping it with, say, an Aston Martin Vantage, what you are going to notice is that it's a bit more comfortable, a bit more upscale, and exactly what you expect from an Aston Martin. Now, for your enjoyment, I will be getting in the second row to see if it is possible to sit back here. Nope, not even at someone at my height around 5'5", is this possible. I thought that with this being a Volante, that getting in the second row would be a lot easier than with the hard top, but not at all, not at all. I don't think you could fit someone back here over the height of 3 feet. Not possible. However, there is some good storage space here. So if you are like me and you have camera gear with you, you can put maybe a DSLR or maybe even a tripod back here and use that storage wisely. But there is no way you're going to have friends in the second row of this car. It's just not going to be possible at all. Now, what about rear cargo space? Well, eyeing this, I'd say you'd be able to fit one set of golf clubs, which is on par with most Grand Tours in this segment. I was able to fit two bags of my camera gear and a gimbal box, which should translate to about two bags of luggage if you are going on a road trip with a significant other. So this car is practical enough where you can load up what you want and leave town for a weekend. And that's why this is an ultimate Grand Tour, and why if you are cross-shopping this with, say, a Ferrari Roma, I would say that the DB11 is a better Grand Tour, because the Roma in my opinion, wanted to kill me when I got behind the wheel, and I felt as though the power management was not the same as a DB11. The DB11 is more linear when it comes to that power, so you can accelerate in the corners and not worry about losing the rear end and getting yourself into trouble. So this car is comfortable, it's practical, but also I think it's daily drivable. So that if you do live in Florida or you live in California, you can drive this car Monday through Friday and not get tired of it. So in closing, the Aston Martin DB11 really is a special car in 2021. It's also a special Grand Tour as well, even though it's in the same price range as some Lamborghinis, Ferraris, Bentleys, and Porsches. It's still a car to keep your eye on. But more importantly, it epitomizes the Grand Touring segment. It's comfortable, it's fun to drive, but also it has some level of practicality. Even though you can't fit anyone in the second row, you can still load up some golf clubs or some bags of luggage and go on a weekend road trip. It's a car you want to be behind the wheel of at all times. And it's really hard to find cars like that in 2021, as everything feels more computerized and not as connected. Whereas when you step behind the wheel of this car and you start driving it, you feel every imperfection, you feel as one with the car, you feel as one with the road, and that is a special sensation that you just don't experience anymore in the automotive industry. So if you're one of the consumers that are looking at Aston Martin or have always wanted to own an Aston Martin and you're like, well, it has a Mercedes-Benz engine, it has Mercedes-Benz technology, maybe I shouldn't go in the Aston Martin direction and look somewhere else, I would say overlook that. Experience this car firsthand. Get behind the wheel, accelerate, drive in all different drive modes, GT, Sport, Sport Plus, and then say you don't like it. It's still classy, it's still sophisticated, it has the true Aston Martin styling, and that's why I feel this car right here is still special, even though it's changed quite a bit from where Aston Martin was 20 years ago. So guys, thank you so much for watching this video. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe for more. Also, make sure to follow me on Instagram at Boston Auto Blog, so you can see what I'm up to and what vehicles I'll be featuring in the future. And I will see you guys next time.